This is Ham Radio Now, episode 213. The Senate gets parity. Yay! The Senate's got parity. Let's find out what I'm talking about. I have a couple of guests here on the Skype line. I've got Mike Lisenco N2YBB. Mike is the ARRL Hudson Division Director. Hello, Mike.
Hi. How are you, Gary?
I'm doing well. It's probably a little warmer down here in North Carolina than it is up in D.C., so we're all suffering with sun.
I don't know. It's as hot as hell up here. It's a swamp. Yeah, really.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's about to turn August, and that means it's about to turn September when the rest of the country sees fall. But now fall doesn't happen down here until October at best. So sitting to your left, screen right, is Chris Imlay, W3KD, ARRL General Counsel. Hello, Chris.
Good evening, Gary.
And welcome to Ham Radio Now. Let's talk politics.
Okay.
Oh, wrong program. No, I guess we're gonna talk politics.
You're gonna talk to them about it anyway.
Yeah. So, what my goal was for this program, what we want to do is convince lots and lots of hams, everybody watching the program, to take some form of action in terms of this Amateur Radio Parity Act. But they're not going to do it just because we tell them to. We're not going to do it even if we convince them it's a great idea. We got to entertain them. We got to tell them entertaining stories. So, so we got to tell them how we got here.
You know?
Yeah, I know. You may or may not be able to actually come up with those stories, but we'll find out. And unfortunately, one of the problems that I always face, at least I think I face, when we're talking about this, is that hams are confused about the antenna regulations that we live under. They continue to be. It's been around since the mid-80s, but they continue to misunderstand and misapply and go wrong directions. So do we have to tell them what this really is again?
You know, let me speak to that, Gary, real quick. It's patently obvious to amateur radio operators who live in suburban areas that all environments aren't created equal. Back in 1985, when we had what I consider to be a much more responsive Federal Communications Commission than we have now, in many, many respects. We, for example, used to be able to just walk in and have a face-to-face meeting with the chief of the private radio bureau, who for a while was an amateur radio operator. And even during the times when the chief of the FCC's private radio bureau wasn't an amateur radio operator, they were always sensitive to amateur radio issues. That has changed over the years. So when the FCC created its amateur radio preemption policy in 1985, it was at a time when there was a good understanding at the management staff level of the needs of amateur radio operators. That's really not the case at the present time. Amateur radio is one of the older technologies that FCC regulates. And that's not to make amateurs feel as though we're small potatoes any more than the broadcast service is. The land mobile radio service, the broadcast service, the amateur radio service, all of them are viewed by FCC as old technologies. Right now, if you're not talking to an FCC staff person about broadband, they're not interested in talking to you at all.
Do they have a really young staff there now? Have they like hired a bunch of kids out of Google and Yahoo?
although you've got a good point, there is a lack of institutional knowledge because there have been really only in the last handful of years a high level of turnover, a high retirement rate. So the staff people that we came along with in the last 35 years or so are not the same people that we're dealing with. We're dealing with today. There has been a good deal of turnover at that agency, and with that, I think a good deal of loss in terms of the sensitivities to the needs and interests of the amateur radio community. But that was just a sort of a preface to the point that that when the FCC created its PRB1 preemption policy back in 1985, it was at a time when there was an understanding that amateur radio had, and it still has, a tremendous value to the general public in terms of emergency communications. And that's what this current legislative effort is really all about. Mm-hmm. Mike?
Yeah, I would agree with that. I mean, I wasn't here when PRB1 was promulgated, but clearly we've reached a point where we don't have the kind of support from the FCC that we used to have, and certainly we desire. And that's made life very difficult for us on the regulatory side.
Right. Well, the thing about PRB1 that I was kind of leading into is that hams are still confused about it. It's been around for 30 years, and hams are still mixed up about what it means. And it's really not that tough. So you're the lawyer. Tell me what it means.
The one thing it's not is it's not a license to put up anything that you want. And I think that becomes problem number one.
It's never been that. The understanding all along was that FCC, back in 1985, was trying to balance what they perceived as a strong federal interest in amateur radio communications with something that was almost inevitably viewed as a purely local function, which is zoning. Municipal land use regulations, county, city, zoning, and building code regulations have always been a purely local function. There are very few Supreme Court cases dealing with zoning. So there are very few constitutional principles that are applicable there. But the whole underpinning of the PRB1 process was that the federal government regulates telecommunications on an exclusive basis. And where local municipal zoning regulations conflict with express federal telecommunications policy, federal telecommunications policy trumps that every single time. So what the FCC was trying to do was to balance the historically local character of local zoning with the federal interest in a strong, vibrant amateur radio service. And frankly, I think they did that brilliantly. It was done by virtue of a declaratory ruling, which is essentially nothing more than a statement of federal policy. Now, later, after the FCC adopted the preemption policy, and I'll describe it in just a second, it codified that. It put the essential holdings of the PRB1 declaratory ruling into a very concise federal regulation. And it's well established that a federal regulation has the preemptive effect, the federal preemptive effect of a federal statute. It has all the force and authority of a United States statute. And that's pretty powerful. Now, what the FCC didn't want to do was to tromp all over this traditionally local regulatory function that the cities and counties had done very effectively for years. So they came up with a very flexible policy. It has three parts. It says, the FCC said, look, there's a strong federal interest in amateur radio communications, and we want to protect that. And so from now on, we're going to judge local zoning regulations and building code regulations and municipal regulatory authority that's exercised over amateur radio facilities by a three-pronged standard. First, municipalities cannot preclude amateur radio communications. Second, they have to reasonably accommodate amateur radio communications. Third, the municipal regulations can't be more restrictive than what the municipality actually needs as a practical matter to accomplish whatever its legitimate purpose is. That's a very flexible policy, and it's a policy that has to be administered in every case by the municipality itself, by the city or county council or the zoning authorities, whichever has the executive power over the zoning regulations. So FCC did not specify a particular antenna height. They didn't specify any particular minimum dimensions for antennas. They left that to the reasonable negotiation between an amateur radio operator in a given case, or a group of amateur radio operators when an ordinance is being negotiated, and the municipal government. And they assumed that everybody would act in good faith. And FCC said, we're not going to be the enforcement authority for this. Amateur radio operators can use our three-pronged PRB1 policy in court proceedings if necessary. But the assumption was that there would be a good faith negotiation between the amateurs and the local municipal land use authorities. And it actually worked to that effect. It worked very well. There have been some court cases, especially at the beginning, that tested the FCC's jurisdiction to effectuate this policy. But in general terms, there has been a successful series of negotiations in zoning cases. Now, I'm sure there are a lot of amateurs out there that'll say, oh, wait a minute, we got into a big fight with the city of San Diego or this, that, or the other municipality. Yeah, sometimes the construction of that fairly generalized policy has been a problem, but that's the exception, not the rule. Overall, this has been very, very effective, and we think it'll be effective in the private land use context as well.
And that is where we are looking at what's currently going on. PRB1 affected only governments, only states, cities, counties, municipalities, their zoning boards, but it didn't touch private contracts, the homeowners associations, the CCNRs, the things that we all sign when we buy a house in a neighborhood that has neighborhood associations and restrictions. It didn't affect those, didn't apply to those. And it's been now several years that the ARRL has been working on the FCC to extend PRB1 to those private contracts.
The league's been working on extending PRB1 to deeded communities since PRB1 was released in 85. So it's been going on for 30 years.
A very long time.
Yeah, but there was the big push maybe 3 years ago when the league specifically said, at least again, let's try this. And the FCC said, we're not going to do it. If you want it done, you got to go to Congress.
Yeah, that would be the 2012.
Sure. Yeah. Let me give you a little bit of background about the application of the PRB1 policy to private land use regulations. I would take issue a little bit with the characterization of private land use regulations as private contracts. Here's how those come about in the first place. When, suppose I'm a developer. I want to create a subdivision in Maryland where I live. So I buy the rights to acquire a large parcel of land that I want to subdivide and build 25 houses on. And I go to my lender, my bank, and I say, I'm a successful developer. I want to create a subdivision. And the lender says, okay, under certain conditions, we'll lend you the money to buy the land, buy the houses, or to build the houses, rather. And and when you sell them, you start paying us back. We have certain conditions on that. We'll lend you the money if you establish and file with the subdivision plat when you start to build a declaration of covenants. A declaration of covenants, sometimes called deed restrictions, out west they're called CC&Rs, covenants, conditions, and restrictions. They're restrictions on the use of land. They're limitations on the bundle of rights that you get when you buy a piece of land. When the developer builds the houses and starts selling them, he starts paying back the bank. The purpose of the bank's insistence on this declaration of covenants is that they want the developer to be able to sell all of the lots without any substantial changes being made that would make the remainder of the lots less saleable. So developer is charged with overseeing the adherence to the covenants, the deed restrictions, until he or she finishes selling the lots and pays the bank back and goes off with his or her profit and on to the next subdivision. At that point, the developer conveys the enforcement authority of the covenants to the homeowners association, which is formed by the developer before he or she leaves. Now, at that point, it becomes the HOA's obligation to enforce the deed restrictions. So these are still just simply restrictions on the use of land. There isn't a buyer of land that says, well, I would like to negotiate with either the developer or the HOA the conditions under which I'm willing to buy a house. There is no negotiation process that's available. Those covenants are simply restrictions on the use of land. And the only decision that a buyer has who comes in is, well, do I buy this piece of land or do I not buy this piece of land? Now, the covenants take two forms, basically. They'll either say no outdoor antennas, or they'll say no outdoor antennas without the approval of the homeowners association in advance. And there are no standards to determine when a homeowners association will grant or deny a particular authorization to put up an antenna. So in the first case, where no antennas are permitted, an amateur radio operator who moves into the community has exactly one choice. Do I buy this piece of land or do I not buy it? You don't always get to choose where you're going to live. Suppose, for example, that I am not an amateur radio operator. I buy a house. I move in. I decide later to become an amateur radio operator. I don't have any ability to negotiate anything about that antenna permit. I'm just simply out of luck. I don't get to use my FCC license. And where there's a restriction that says no antennas without the approval of the homeowners association, that's not a negotiable provision. And if I come into a neighborhood that has that type of regulation, I can't know in advance whether or not I'm going to be able to put up an antenna or not. So there's no meeting of the minds between the buyer and the seller of land there. I can only get a decision about my antenna after I move into the neighborhood, because the HOA will not give you an anticipatory opinion about whether or not I'm going to be able to put any sort of antenna in or not.
Yeah, they might, I suppose, but...
Well, they don't as a practical.
Yeah. You were saying that you don't consider them private contracts. So in what way are they not a contract if it's not going to take us down too deep a rabbit hole?
Good question. A contract requires a meeting of the minds between the two parties to the contract. If there is not the ability to make any negotiation whatsoever, you don't have a contractual relationship at all. Instead, what you have is a preclusion based on restrictions that apply to all parcels of land in the subdivision. They run with the land, they bind subsequent buyers, and they don't permit of any exceptions. Now, it was held a long time ago by the Supreme Court that federal communications policy trumps even private land use regulations. That's not a taking of land under the Constitution. It's simply a supervening authority. Just the same as racial covenants were invalidated by the Supreme Court back in the 1940s, private land use regulations which conflict with express telecommunications policy are preemptible. That's not to say they're automatically preempted on their face, but they are subject to being preempted.
Yeah, and the FCC has decided not to preempt them on their own authority, but to tell ARRL to go to Congress if they want it done.
Yeah. They're looking for guidance from Congress.
Yeah. We've asked FCC several times since the PRB1 declaratory ruling was issued, and we've told them, look, we think you made a mistake back in 1985 in not applying your reasonable accommodation standard to all types of land use regulations. There is no difference in the effect on the strong federal interest in amateur radio communications, whether or not an amateur station is precluded by a zoning regulation or whether it's precluded by a deed restriction. The effect is the same. The amateur radio station cannot be constructed. It cannot be operated. So the FCC said, we agree with you, but before we agree to apply our preemption policy across the board, we insist that you get us some guidance from Congress. And there's the reason they take that position is because in 1996, Congress instructed the FCC to enact a preemptive regulation with respect to both municipal land use regulations and private land use regulations with respect to over-the-air video reception devices in residences. And that applied to television broadcast antennas, it applied to satellite dish antennas, and it applied to private microwave wireless cable antennas, which you don't see very much anymore. So FCC did that, and Congress instructed FCC to do that so as to create a level playing field in video delivery services so that Congress could get out of cable television regulation. And the FCC enacted that, followed the congressional instruction, and created some rules that made it impossible for homeowners associations and local zoning authorities to preclude television broadcast antennas of any size and satellite dish antennas of up to a meter in diameter in residential areas. So the FCC was very comfortable with the guidance that they got from Congress in that respect, and so they followed the same format with us and said, we'll be happy to extend our reasonable accommodation policy across the board, but you have to get us some guidance from Congress. So that's when our effort began mid-year last year to get some legislation.
Now, I think before that, just before that, Congress went to the FCC and said, we want a study. And the FCC ran a study, and if I recall correctly, their conclusions were, nah, the hams don't really have much of a problem.
Well, it's a half glass. It's a half full, half empty glass issue.
Here's what happened there. We decided that we wanted to have, before we went to Congress and said, look, preempt private land use regulations as they apply to amateur radio antennas to the same extent that they apply to zone municipal zoning. We needed a factual record to back up what it is that we wanted to do. So we obtained legislation that required FCC to conduct this study. Originally, our intention was to have Department of Homeland Security conduct the study. We knew that DHS understood the value of amateur radio emergency communications probably far better than the FCC did. And our intention was that DHS was to conduct that study. But the way the legislation got passed, it was supposed to be a collaborative effort between FCC and DHS. DHS, I think, ended up dissatisfied with the extent to which they were able to contribute to the study that the FCC created. And what the FCC ended up doing was simply issuing a call for comments. And they took the comments from the public, and they never really did what Congress told them to do, which was to actually do a study. What they did instead was they just issued a report based on the comments that were received, and they just summarized what the comments said. They didn't make any independent findings of their own.
Would you say that that was sort of a result of what you were talking about before with the FCC, of them considering us old business and not that much interested?
Non-responsiveness on the agency's
part. Yeah, and I think it also, you know, it's very hard for the FCC to admit, you know, after nearly 30 years that, well, perhaps they were wrong. And so, you know, typical bureaucratic answer would be to maintain the status quo, which is exactly what I think they did.
However, the value of the docket proceeding was in the record, the factual record that was created. There was a very, very strong record created in that established, A, that there is a continued important value in amateur radio communications for emergency communications and disaster response communications. Second, that private land use regulations are a very serious burden on any ability of the amateur service to extend and expand on its valuable volunteer functions in emergency communications. And third, that there are many, many instances of preclusive private land use regulations which make it impossible for amateur radio operators in many suburban, perhaps most suburban areas, to conduct their volunteer activities. The record is exceptional in making those factual findings. And with almost no dissent, the FCC looked at that record and made what we consider to be some exceptionally weak findings, but there certainly is nothing to offset the factual record that was created there.
Yeah, those of us who read it probably said, wait, did they read this before they came up with their conclusions, or did they just kind of make it up?
What they said in that report was it didn't denigrate the factual record. It just said, well, amateur radio operators say this, and a couple of other commenters say this, and we're not going to be able to find that amateur radio operators can't purchase real property in some areas that aren't burdened by private land use regulations. But they didn't make any findings with respect to the trends, with respect to the language of the preclusive language of the CCNRs. What they ended up saying at the end of that report is, we're not going to do anything on our own. We're making this report to Congress because we were ordered to do it. If Congress should see fit to require us to extend our limited preemption policy to all types of land use regulations, and that's exactly what we're going to do, and we're going to do it pronto. So overall, it was not a completely unfair response that the FCC did. The gripe that we have, and I think it's a reasonable criticism, is that they didn't do an independent evaluation of the issue that Congress told them to study. They didn't do any independent study at all. They just summarized what the comments said. There was no investment of time or effort or commitment on FCC staff's part at all. And that's not what Congress told them to do. But they did say, and this is the part that we're carrying forward here on the Hill right now, they did say that that should Congress give them some direction, then they'll follow it.
Yeah.
And that's probably as much as we could expect from the agency at that point in time.
Yeah, I can sort of tell that you are speaking from a position of someone who will have to deal with the FCC again soon.
I've been with this agency for 35 years, and it's probably going to be another 10 or 15 before I'm through. So, overall, I think they're diligent folks, and they're trying to do a good job. I was a lot more comfortable with the folks we were dealing with 20 years ago than I am today.
Mm. All right. Well, I think we are almost up to date. Last year, this bill that we were hoping for was introduced in the House. It didn't go anywhere. It died at the end of the last congressional session, as many, many, many bills do, far more than ever get passed. It was reintroduced this year, a little bit earlier, getting lots of co-sponsors. And then the thing that surprised me a lot, and if you watch the program I did with Bill Marine and Carl Bowman on the House bill a couple months ago, the thing that surprised me a lot is suddenly there's the Senate bill, and the Senate bill has appeared, and boom. That was, first of all, it was absolutely necessary because nothing happens in terms of making a law without it going through both houses of Congress, and I didn't expect it. I really didn't expect a Senate bill, at least not this year. So, did it surprise you guys, or did you know what was going on? Well, I guess the whole rest of this program is what was going on behind the scenes.
It took months to finally find a sponsor and co-sponsor. It was something that that all of us working on as a team. We're very happy with the way it worked out because you couldn't get any better than the chairman of the subcommittee as the sponsor. And that just absolutely floored us. I don't think we ever expected that.
You know,
that's Senator Roger Wicker is a senator from Mississippi, and he is the sponsor. Richard Blumenthal from Connecticut is the co-sponsor. Which committee is it that you're referring to that he's the chairman of?
Senator Wicker is the chairman of the House.
Senate.
I'm sorry, the Senate Communications Subcommittee of the Commerce Committee. It's the Committee of Jurisdiction on Telecommunications Matters. Years ago, Perry Williams, W1UED, used to be the Washington area coordinator for the ARRL, and he'd come down to Washington from Connecticut every week for two or three days a week, and he would do what Mike and I do a lot of right now, just stumping around from office to office looking for support for our legislative initiatives. And Perry described the greatest asset that he had as something he referred to as Maxim's Mafia, referring to Hiram Percy Maxim and the network of amateur radio operators that we have out there in the field. The reason Senator Wicker became interested in our bill was because he was contacted by a Mississippi amateur radio operator who was politically interested in and happened to have a connection with Senator Wicker. And made an approach to Senator Wicker about working on our bill, and he mentioned the House bill. And after he had done that at some meeting that Senator Wicker was at in Mississippi, that amateur contacted the ARRL division director, David Norris. David and the amateur contacted Kay Craigie, the president of ARRL. And Kay dispatched Mike and me and our legislative consulting group that we work with here. And we went to speak with Senator Wicker's office, and lo and behold, they said, yeah, we want to work with you. It's Maxim's Mafia at work here. It's the amateur radio operators in the field that made this happen.
Yeah. So this truly began as a very grassroots effort, and not anywhere near your level, just, you know, right down to the state.
When Mike and I go into an office, we like to tell people on the House side and the Senate side how many amateur radio operator licensees there are in the congressional district or in the state and the Senate side. And that's an important factor because it shows how many potential votes we're bringing to the table. It's something that's interesting to a congressional office or a Senate office, but that doesn't cut it with them, because what they need to see is some level of interest from that same group of amateur radio operators.
Yeah, you have to remember, you have somebody from Maryland and somebody from New York walking into any office, whether it be congressional or Senate, and the first thing they're going to ask us is, well, what kind of support do you have from our constituents? This is one of the reasons why those letters that we keep on asking for is so important. And I can't tell you how many times we've actually convinced a member of the House to sign on to the bill because of the constituent input they've received, either by letter or by email. It's just, I was surprised at how important they were, because my initial gut would have been, oh, nobody's going to read these letters, but I was sorely mistaken.
The absolute worst case scenario is where Mike and I go into a Senate office and say, look, there are 15,000 amateur radio operators in the state of XYZ.
Right.
And they say to us, but we haven't heard from any of them. and if they haven't heard from any of them, then that actually works against us.
Yeah. So, you're making a point I was going to ask about, which is the total number of hams in any state, even the most populous ham radio states, is very small compared to the total number of residents, citizens, voters, no matter what. So I was going to say, well, you know, what is it that gets us any attention at all when we're numbers that small? And it seems to be being active, getting hams to sign these letters, to make the calls, things like that. All that stuff is necessary, and it gives us weight beyond our pure numbers, which are pretty small.
You know, look, when you take a survey, you're not surveying a mass population. You're surveying what you think is a representative amount for that interest group. The same thing here. We'll bring in, you know, our membership, of course, is not every ham in the United States. So, you know, they still, though, represent that constituency. So let's say if there's 7,000 hams in the district, or in the state for that matter, and we can pull in 30, 40, 50 letters, that says a lot. And they see that as being active voters within the constituency of either that congressional representative or that senator.
Right.
And really that's what it boils down to them is if they can do something that helps their constituents, they know that at some point that will equate with votes, and you know, it's really that simple.
ARRL is a nonprofit, 501c3 tax exempt organization. We can't devote a significant amount of our resources to advocacy, and we absolutely can't spend a penny toward contributing to a campaign. What we can do is we can assure these offices that our issue is of extreme importance to our members in that congressional district or in that state. And we are perfectly able to give each office a list of the names and addresses of all of the amateurs in that congressional district or that state. And that's something of great value when a congressperson or a senator is looking to get reelected. It's not really small numbers. It's actually significant numbers. And if we can persuade the congressional office that which we know is absolutely true, that private land use regulations are a cancer in the amateur radio service, and we've described it as something that is creating death by a thousand cuts, that and bodes ill for the future of amateur radio, and therefore this is an important issue to the 1,700 amateur radio operators in a particular congressional district. that represents potentially a lot of votes. And if it's an issue of importance to that 1,700 person group, then they're going to be very grateful for the support of that congressperson.
You also have to remember that voter turnout in any general election is not that high. So let's say for the sake of argument, there are 100,000 people in a congressional district. And if you have voter turnout of 30%, that's only 30,000 voters. Now you take a look at the amount of hams. If there are 7,000 hams, a special interest group that's going to go to the trouble of making themselves known through legislative advocacy, they know that these people are going to vote. And so it's not an insubstantial amount given the larger picture. In fact, what was it? I don't remember which state it was today, but it wasn't a large state. They had roughly 1,700, 2,000 hams in the state. But they actually said that's a great amount of voters. Well, they didn't say voters, of hams, because it turns out to be X amount of votes in a relatively small state.
I think it was Delaware. Yeah. And you know, we did get the at-large congressperson from Delaware as a sponsor on the House bill. And the way we did that was by bringing in probably 150 letters that had been signed by Delaware amateur radio operators from, I don't know, Dayton or some other convention where there happened to be a lot of hams from Delaware there. That represented a strong showing of commitment to the bill. So we're absolutely dependent on the support from individuals.
Here's another example. We last month visited an upstate New York office where they said specifically, we haven't seen anything from anybody in terms of amateur radio input. Could you have them send us letters or emails? An email went out to that specific the membership from that specific congressional district, and within 3 weeks, that congresswoman was on the bill. There are stories about like this that we could just keep on talking about, but the bottom line is that the input that we get from the membership to kind of put pressure on their representatives to support the bill is extremely important.
Yes,
it's extremely important. And the more we are able to carry into an office when we visit, creates that much more value, and it gives us a better entree into the office. Today we walked into a couple of offices where we had in excess of 50 or 60 letters that we've collected at either various hamfests or conventions. Including letters that were written in by people having seen the amounts of calls for letters to come into the league through our regulatory office. They all get forwarded down to D.C. and they all get hand-delivered. They are a tremendous entree into these offices.
We like to do it that way. It's a little more difficult to for us to deal with some emails that go directly to a congressman or senator's office. But we certainly don't want to discourage that from being done that way. It's just a much better way for us to batch deliver the letters in writing. Emails tend to disappear.
And you wouldn't know if someone sent an email, unless they sent you a copy of it, I suppose.
No, right. There's no way of knowing. You have to take it on good faith that when somebody says they'll do something, they do it.
So when we're talking about these letters that people have signed at Hamfests being hand-delivered, hold up your hands. Hold in front of the camera. Hold up your hands, guys. Those are the hands. Those are the hands that are hand-delivering.
Well, some of the hands. There are other hands, too.
Well, because I think everybody thinks, yeah, you're just getting a messenger service to bring them over, and maybe sometimes it happens. But.
No, that would denigrate the value of the letters. I mean, you have to present them to the staff person, either the legislative counsel or the or a legislative assistant or a legislative correspondent.
Yeah, whomever you get in there to meet.
We'll that's the first thing that a staffer does when they open up our package of materials that we deliver. We have a package that we deliver. It includes a copy of the bill, the Dear Colleague letter that Senator Wicker and Senator Blumenthal issued, urging their colleagues in the Senate to sign on to the bill as co-sponsors. We have an editorial that Dave Sumner wrote about the legislative effort. We have a bullet point memo that explains the bill and the need for it. We have a backup thing that describes the value of amateur radio and emergency communications. But what they go for every single time is the constituent list.
So I'm looking over here at the web. And we're talking about, I want to talk about for a moment, what specific hams can do. This is the league story. It's been out for a long time now, so it's, you won't see this on the top of the news, the front page, but you can easily search for it if you just go to this little search box, this website search, and type in the word parity, which is what I did to get here. And you'll see what is sort of the original story. But this is where you'll find what it is you can do to do this yourselves. And if you're not going to a ham fest that's got a league booth in it, then there are there's a sample letter that you can print out and sign, right, things like that. So all of these links here, they're, the sample letter that I could send to my congressman. All of these things are available and easy to use. But again, the most important thing of this is not to send it yourself, but to send it to league headquarters, and then it goes into these hands. Hold up those hands again. It goes into these hands and gets carried through the halls of Washington and hand-delivered to, right, the people you need to take
you
it to.
You have to remember that if they mail them themselves to D.C., they may never get seen. They'll wind up going through security, probably spend a generation there before they get released to go to the office. And by that time, that person's no longer in office.
You know, one thing I'd like to note about the grassroots effort, though, honestly, very seldom do Mike and I get to speak with a congressman directly or a senator directly. It doesn't really work that way that often. These are busy folks. Occasionally we do, and it's a little easier for us to see our good friend Greg Walden over on the House side. He's an amateur radio operator. He understands us very, very well.
He's the only ham in Congress now, right? There's another one?
Yeah, I keep on forgetting who it is. There's one other active ham who's a congressman, and then occasionally you run across a staffer who's a ham.
But my point is that one way that individual amateur radio operators can make a big impact here is to attend local functions where a congressman or a senator appears, and that happens a lot. It's easy to get real quality face time with a congressperson or senator in the home district or in the state. It's also very easy to get an appointment in a congressional district office. And there's no reason why you can't just drop by, right, tell them what's on your mind, and put it in your own words. They're very, very receptive to what you want. And after you do that, if you tell us you've done it, it makes it so much easier for us to follow up with the congressional staff in Washington. It opens a lot of doors for us.
So if you just drop by your congressional office, your local office, you're not likely to talk to the congressperson or a senator. You're going to talk to a staffer.
You're more than likely wind up speaking to a staffer. And there's nothing wrong with that, because they have a tremendous amount of input into what the congressman or senator will be doing in terms of legislation. Typically, what will happen in the district is if you're lucky enough to see either the representative or the division director, say, that meeting will go one way, whereas a staffer will more than likely take the information pass it on, but eventually it'll wind its way down to the legislative staff in D.C.
That's right. But I'm talking about something actually a little different.
Right.
A good friend of mine, WB5RFK in Jasper, Texas, regularly sits down and has coffee and donuts with his congressman on Saturday mornings at a local coffee shop in Jasper, Texas. Now, not every congressperson does that kind of thing, but a lot of them do. And you'll find that if you go to the congressional person's website, they'll tell you where they're going to be. And sometimes they have regular interactions with folks that are in their district, and it really is easy to get FaceTime with them directly under those circumstances.
It would also help us if we were to know who out there is politically connected and has these kinds of relationships, and let us help coordinate the effort so that we get these people on board. It works to our benefit if we can know what's going on, at all levels. I know that I've sent out emails to my division asking for people who are involved in local political clubs, have access to legislators, may or may not know these individuals in person. And I'll tell you, we've picked up a couple of congressional co-sponsors because of the fact that people know people or know a representative well enough that they can talk to them and actually just come down and say, can you help us?
We've found that it's amazingly easy to get support for this legislation. The bill sells itself. It's an absolutely bipartisan bill on both the House side and the Senate side. And these days, that's a very unusual circumstance.
Well, there is going to be some opposition. Homeowners associations have some national organizations, and we've seen some things on their websites that have indicated they're aware of this.
But we haven't seen them up on Capitol Hill, and that's a fairly important factor. It's one thing for a homeowners association or their umbrella organization to say, contact your congressperson. This has an adverse effect on homeowners association jurisdiction. Frankly, they don't have an argument. So it's really, really tough for them to come up here on Capitol Hill and say, we oppose reasonable accommodation. How do you do that? There's no logic behind that argument.
And they don't have passion. I'm guessing they don't have the kind of passion that hams do for this argument because, how do regulators ever have passion? They kind of don't.
They don't. One of the things that would be fair to say is that back in 1996, when Congress told FCC to preempt private land use regulations that affect over-the-air television reception devices, FCC took a fairly heavy hand on the homeowners associations. And one of the things that Mike and I like to point out to Congress people that we meet with and senators' offices is that what we're looking for is something considerably different than what FCC did back in 1996. We're not trying to take away the decision-making authority of the homeowners associations. We're trying, however, to create a balance between the homeowners association's reasonable concern about aesthetics in the community, which is their primary function after all, and our interest in maintaining this important volunteer emergency communications resource, which is a benefit to the community anyway.
You have to remember that when PRB1 was first promulgated, the municipal zoning boards did not lose their authority over the amateur radio operator. What it did was it put us in a position where we can negotiate with the municipal zoning board in good faith and together come up with something that meets both needs and of the municipality as well as the needs of the amateur. The same thing would happen with the extension of the same PRB1 ruling to private land use restrictions. At no point would the HOA lose its authority, just like municipalities didn't lose their authority but they would be obligated to sit down and negotiate in good faith with the amateur so that they could come up with something that's satisfactory to both.
So when we make that explanation, what we've left for the HOAs to say is, oh no, we can't support this. We oppose this because we want to be able to tell the amateur radio operators to go to the devil.
Yeah, what they lose, if anything, is the absolute no. They lose that.
That's right. That's exactly right.
So a couple minutes ago, you were talking about the individual ham who could work at the grassroots level and make an approach to their congressional office or their Senate office. And, you know, I've been dealing with ham radio and the media and the public for a long, long time. And I know how difficult that is, not because it's difficult to make the contacts, but we individual hams get tongue-tied and have a really tough time explaining ourselves without a lot of jargon, with a lot of technical details that baffle and then, you know, do the Migo, you know, yeah, okay, when are you going to be done?
It's not easy.
And so rather than you have how people tell people, rather than have you tell people how to do it, what I'd like you to do is spend a little time describing how you do it.
I'm having trouble hearing because of all the noise.
Sorry, we do have a lot of background noise.
Yeah, I guess we should explain that you guys are guests in a law office. It's a law office, right?
No, we're actually guests at the Keelan Group, which is the legislative consulting firm that
there you go. The cameraman's doing a good job.
Don't upstage an actor. Not a good thing to do.
that the ARRL uses. And the Keelan Group is right up here on Capitol Hill. We're a few steps away from the Rayburn House office building right now. And they're having one of their many receptions downstairs for some congressperson or other. And so we're being hosted as best they can accommodate us.
Well, what are you doing here talking to me? Get down there and lobby these guys.
Well, we'll probably do that shortly.
No, you can't lobby. So what I was saying is that, and that's why it's noisy, and we can't tell them to stop. So so don't worry about that. But what I was asking then is for you guys to just tell us a couple stories. When you go into one of these offices, how does it go? And how do you what do you say?
Okay, the script is something that Mike and I do on an ad hoc basis, and we work very well off of each other. Usually, Mike will describe who we are, who we represent, what amateur. We always ask, how familiar are you with amateur, or sometimes referred to as ham radio? And the typical answer is not very much. We have a few exceptions from time to time, but occasionally somebody will say, oh yeah, my grandfather was a ham radio.
I was just going to say, my grandpa's got one of those things in his basement, and the big antenna up on them.
Surprisingly so.
But the typical answer is, I don't know much. Give me the dollar tour.
Yeah.
And Mike does that. I'll
tell him, oh, so you need the dollar tour and not the nickel tour. And they said, oh, yeah, give me the dollar tour. And I said, well, it's the same as the nickel tour anyway. So you're going to get it. And what we'll do is we'll set up the scene and so that we lead into why we're there. And then you got a ping pong ball going back and forth.
we give them the packet of information. We tell them we're there about the bill, but then we describe a little bit about amateur radio and the value in emergency communications, the value of amateur radio in international goodwill, the value of amateur radio in technical self-training.
Yeah.
We explain that we bounce signals off the moon.
Right.
That
we'll let
this
them know
is not your grandfather's
ham radio.
We're
not a bunch of 80-year-old men sitting in a basement, you know, going like this. Can you hear me? Can you hear me? And we do explain that, indeed, we are, you know, involved in the cutting edge of digital technology, and that amateur radio has provided some of the items that you find every day in telecommunications. So we don't want to leave them with the opinion that we're a passe group. The other thing that's very important to note is that in 2015, there were more licenses issued than ever before in the history of amateur radio.
And it really is impressive. I remember back in the late 80s, we were working on a piece of legislation that expressed the sense of Congress of the value of amateur radio. And we wanted to use that in various FCC proceedings and in antenna cases and things like that. And I remember that legislation very well, and I have a record of it back in my office. And we were bragging about the fact that there were more than 400,000 amateur radio operators licensed by the commission. Well, now there are more than 730,000 amateur radio operators licensed by the commission, and that's not that long ago.
Right. And in fact, I'll say to them, you'll assume that the golden age of amateur radio, you'll think, was post-war. And they'll say, well, yes. And I'll say, well, there were also like three times the amount of hams now than there were then, roughly 250,000 hams post-war. So now we're up to 750,000. It's a substantial change in the amount of hams. And then we'll lead into why we're there and discuss the bill itself and what's and why, you know, it's important to us and why they should support it. And, you know, and then keep our fingers crossed.
And yeah, and we do tell them that I think it's an important fact that this is not an intrusion on the Homeowners Association's jurisdiction. It's simply an extension of a long existing, long tested, reasonable accommodation policy, and it should apply across the board to all types of land use regulations. It doesn't make any sense otherwise.
Yeah, you know, we're really selling mom and apple pie when it comes down to it. It just to us it boggles the mind how you cannot accept the ability and the willingness to negotiate in good faith. And when we put it like that, it's very hard for them to counter with, no, we don't want to do that.
The bill really does sell itself, but it requires an explanation, and that explanation usually takes about half an hour, sometimes a little bit more. You know, we've been on our feet since 8 o'clock this morning, and it's now, you know, 6:30. So, it's a long day, and we're going to do the same thing again on the House side all day tomorrow. We have
14 or 15 visits, and the same thing we did today. So, over the course of 2 days, we're talking about 30 offices that we covered.
So, in your visits today, how many times were you talking to an actual senator or congressperson, or how many times were you talking to staff?
Today we didn't get to meet with any individual members of Congress. We saw a lot of them in the hall, including some whose offices we later visited, like
Bob Menendez.
It's a regular thing to be walking along the halls and see Senator McCain walk by, you know, and you say hi, Senator McCain, and he'll say hi, and it's very collegial up here. But they're busy. We're going to be up here a lot in August when both houses of Congress are in recess because the staff is still going to be here working, and we get to meet with the staffers here then.
Yeah, and since he'll be home, that's a great time to try to make district visits with the members.
Yeah, I was going to say with the recess coming up, which starts next week, I think.
No, today was the House apparently closed out today, so they're done, and the Senate will go through next week. And then they're done for the month of August.
Okay, so that's your chance.
During that time, even those who we might have persuaded today to sign on to the Senate bill won't be able to. Well, unless they do it before the recess starts,
they won't
be able to do that during the recess. And so we're not going to really know what the success of our efforts have been for this trip this week
until
September.
Yeah. So you won't see their names appear during the month of August.
But we've had quite an influx of co-sponsors on the House side. We have now 94, and we hope to round that out to well over 100 by the beginning of September.
And what do you think about more Senate sponsors? What kind of reaction are you getting there?
Well, it would be nice to have a couple of dozen Senate. Co-sponsors for this bill. In the Senate, it doesn't really quite work the same way as it does in the House side. We've had some in-depth meetings with the committee chairman for the Senate Commerce Committee about strategies for moving the bill in the Senate. And ironically, even without any more co-sponsors over in the Senate than we have right now, it's entirely likely and possible that the Senate bill could move before the House bill does.
Yeah, and what was very interesting today was the fact that out of the 14 visits, a number of staffers told us they were already familiar with the bill. So the fact is that word gets around apparently on the Senate side in a much different manner than it does in the House.
And we're very grateful for Senator Wicker from Mississippi and Senator Blumenthal from Connecticut for working so hard themselves from their own offices to move this bill.
Yeah.
They not only issued a dear colleague letter, they're actually going out and stumping around for this bill themselves, and we're eminently grateful for that.
So people are probably not going to be reading about this on the front page of their local newspaper, unless it's a very small local newspaper and you had a local ham that got in the middle of it. But you know, for the medium and large cities, it's not going to make big time news. This is, do I insult you and the effort if I call it small potatoes government?
I'm afraid I missed that. I'm sorry.
Oh. Yeah,
very noisy.
I was saying, if I call this small potatoes, is that offensive or is that pretty accurate?
Oh, you mean?
Oh, no, not at all. No, you know, honestly, this is not a huge piece of legislation,
right, like
the Iran treaty.
although I think a number of us would consider it to be as important.
But
well, yes.
But to be honest with you, that works very much to our advantage. It's understood that this is at once a non-controversial bill. It's a very bipartisan bill. It's one that can be moved along, marked up, and hearings had without a whole lot of expenditure of resources. And it makes Congress look good to pass legislation like this. We're very happy with the position of this bill.
The fact that it is small potatoes really does work to our benefit. If it was to be a more controversial bill, we would never have gotten this far this quickly.
Okay, I'll shout a little bit over the over the background noise. The prospects for it. I'm sure you don't want to predict what might happen. That's just, you know, it's going to be way too difficult to make a prediction, but describe what the possible routes are to a finish of this, whether it happens this year or not. Does it get attached to another bill? Can it possibly happen standalone?
But how the bill's going to pass? It would be impossible to describe the variety of circumstances under which this bill could pass. It could pass on its own. It could pass on its own in either the Senate or the House, or it could be attached to another piece of legislation. There have been discussions on both sides of Congress about attaching this to an FCC reauthorization bill, possibly a Communications Act rewrite bill. But the problem with that is that those are not controversial bits of legislation. And at least on the Senate side, we've been told that their preference is probably to move this bill on its own. And the way the route that would take would be to go to what they call markup, where the subcommittee would actually consider the bill and make any editorial changes that they would like in it. They would schedule it for hearings. They would invite us to testify. They would invite perhaps some homeowners association representatives to come in and testify, and we would welcome that. There would be written testimony, oral testimony, and then there would be a report that would be issued by the subcommittee, and ultimately by the report, the bill would be reported out to the full committee. It could pass toward the end of the year in one of a series of procedural mechanisms that are available for for a bill passing very quickly. I think that both on the Senate and the House, ideally, we would like to see this bill marked up sometime this fall. If that doesn't happen, maybe that'll happen next year. We have until the end of 2016 to get this bill passed, and we have every intention of doing that before then.
I think that is a pretty good way to wrap things up. We could go much longer. You guys went to a board meeting. I'd love to ask you questions about that. Now, let me ask one question. Dave Sumner announced he's going to step down as a CEO of ARRL, starting effective next May, I think. Was that a surprise to you guys?
Is it a surprise to you that that Dave Sumner has announced his resignation effective next May?
No. I mean, no.
He's been doing it for a long time.
You know, look, you would expect everybody at some point to retire, you know. So is it a surprise? No.
I can't say it's a surprise at all to me. I've had the pleasure of working with Dave Sumner for 35 years now. It's been a great pleasure. I'm personally sorry that I won't have the opportunity to continue to work with him. I love the man like a brother. But as Mike says, there are more important things than working all the time. It's taken a long time for me to realize that.
Yeah. Well, I guess... go ahead, Mike. I guess it would be a great thing for him to be able to notch his belt with this one before he retires. So we don't know if it can happen, but we can help. We can at least push it that direction. So Chris Imlay, W3KD, ARRL General Counsel, Mike Lisenco, N2YBB, ARRL Hudson Division Director, thanks very much for explaining what goes on there on the halls of Washington, the bastions of power.
Thanks for having us.
Good evening.
All right. That's it for this episode of Ham Radio Now. Arvin, sitting back there, is the Chief Financial Officer, and he wants me to remind you that Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. So if you enjoyed this program, got something out of it, please stop by hamradionow.tv, click on Arvin's icon, and you can help us out financially. Still 24 or so hours to go as I finish this up in the Kickstarter for Tapper DCC, and it is surging. So we'll see what happens there. And that is it. I'll see you whenever we do the next episode. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ 73, over and out.